Random House Audio presents Mother-Daughter Wisdom, Creating a Legacy of Physical and Emotional Health. This is the author, Dr. Christiane Northrup. Mothers and daughters, the bond that wounds, the bond that heals. The mother-daughter relationship is at the headwaters of every woman's health. Our bodies and our beliefs about them were formed in the soil of our mother's emotions, beliefs, and behaviors. Even before birth, our mother provides us with our first experience of nurturing. It is from her that we learn what it is to be a woman and care for our bodies. Our cells divided and grew to the beat of her heart. Our skin, hair, heart, lungs, and bones were nourished by her blood. Blood that was awash with the neurochemicals formed in response to her thoughts, beliefs, and emotions. If she was fearful, anxious, or deeply unhappy about her pregnancy, our bodies knew it. If she felt safe, happy, and fulfilled, we felt that too. Our bodies and those of our daughters were created by a seamless web of nature and nurture, of biology informed by consciousness, that we can trace back to the beginning of time. Thus, every daughter contains her mother and all the women who came before her. The unrealized dreams of our maternal ancestors are part of our heritage. To become optimally healthy and happy, each of us must get clear about the ways in which our mother's history both influenced and continues to inform our state of health, our beliefs, and how we live our lives. Every woman who heals herself helps heal all the women who came before her and all those who will come after her. A mother's often unconscious influence on her daughter's health is so profound that years ago I had to accept that my medical skills were only a drop in the bucket compared to the unexamined and ongoing influence of her mother. If a woman's relationship with her mother was supportive and healthy, and if her mother had given her positive messages about her female body and how to care for it, my job as a physician was easy. Her body, mind, and spirit were already programmed for optimal health and healing. If, on the other hand, her mother's influence was problematic, or if there was a history of neglect, abuse, alcoholism, or mental illness, then I knew that my best efforts would probably fall short. Real long-term health solutions would become possible only when my patient realized the impact of her background and then took steps to change this influence. No other childhood experience is as compelling as a young girl's relationship with her mother. Each of us takes in at the cellular level how our mother feels about being female, what she believes about her body, how she takes care of her health, and what she believes is possible in life. Her beliefs and behaviors set the tone for how well we learn to care for ourselves as adults. We then pass this information, either consciously or unconsciously, onto the next generation. Maternal attention, an essential, lifelong nutrient. When a TV camera focuses on audience members in the studio or at sporting events, what does the person on camera shout out? More often than not, it's, "Hi, Mom!" Each of us has a primal need to be seen and noticed by our mothers. A daughter's need for her mother is biologic, and it continues throughout her life. Not only was our mother's body the source of life for us, but it was her face that we looked to see how we were doing. By gazing into our mother's eyes and experiencing her response to us, we learned crucial first lessons about our own worth. Maternal ambivalence, our cultural legacy. Both men and women in this society are encouraged to view having a baby and raising a child as the most significant achievement in a woman's life, and on many levels it is. For a significant number of women, however, motherhood brings up far more conflict and ambivalence than we feel comfortable admitting, lest we be labeled as bad mothers whose love for our children is suspect. The epidemic of undiagnosed and untreated postpartum depression and the toll it takes on society speak volumes. Who wouldn't be ambivalent about the one decision in a woman's life that totally changes her future? Contrary to the myth Nurturing isn't an innate default setting in the human female. It is active and requires strength, stamina, will, intelligence, and determination. All of the qualities that we tend to associate with maleness. And yet, because femaleness has so long been seen as inferior to maleness, the work of nurturing and raising our young has also been denigrated. Instead of being honest about the less than wonderful aspects of motherhood, however, we over-sentimentalize it on the one hand, while under-supporting and downplaying the actual work involved on the other. The energy of giving and nurturing others unconditionally draws on all the organs of the fourth chakra or energy center, the breasts, heart, lungs, upper spine, and shoulders. But the love that makes maternal nurturance so life-affirming must be replenished regularly. When a woman puts her own personal and emotional needs on the back burner or forgets entirely that she has them, the energy of her fourth chakra inevitably becomes diminished by resentment, anger, grief, longing, pining for contact, and pure fatigue. This is the energy pattern that invites breast, shoulder, heart, and lung problems, and diseases in those areas cause the majority of deaths and disabilities in women. The minute a woman decides she is worthy of love and care, things begin to change. A woman who has the courage to break the martyrdom cycle will be ensuring her own health and helping her daughter or other loved ones do the same. When your daughter witnesses this, she will be less likely to carry the mother burden on into her own life. There is a way to create healthy, sustainable relationships with our own mothers and daughters without getting sick, feeling sucked dry, or resentful. We can relate to and support each other and still be free to live our lives as fully as possible without the tyranny of guilt and obligation that so often plays itself out in this relationship. And yes, we can create a legacy of health for our daughters and their daughters to come. Mother-daughter wisdom will show you the way. Embracing your unique mothering style. There is no one right way to be a mother. I've found it helpful to think of mothering styles, or nurturing styles if you don't have children, as falling somewhere along a spectrum. Once you identify your mother's style and also your own, you'll be better able to appreciate and understand how you've influenced each other and what choices are right for you. At one end of the spectrum is the non-traditional mother or nurturer, the woman who is primarily turned inward toward meeting creative needs that come from deep within her. My mother falls into this category. In women like my mother, activating the motherhood and nurturing circuits tends to take a toll physically unless they also have a lot of practical support. Though they love their children as much as anyone, they are not biologically wired for motherhood to fulfill them totally at the deepest levels. For my mother, skiing and other outdoor activities were as necessary as oxygen. When we were little, instead of missing a day of skiing, she'd bundle us all up and take us with her. We all learned to ski by the age of 2. At the other end of the spectrum is the traditional mother. Having babies and caring for them is the happiest and most fulfilling activity of her life. This mother's focus is primarily on her children, and she often doesn't feel the need for a career or outer interests. The traditional mother may go through considerable difficulty at midlife if she perceives that she's no longer needed by her family. She often continues her caregiving role throughout her life by doing such things as volunteering to care for her grandchildren or hosting holiday gatherings at which she prepares most of the food. Somewhere near the middle of the spectrum is the woman who combines both the traditional and non-traditional types of mothers. I fall into this combination mother category. Like my mother before me, I was never interested in babies until I had my own children, and my need to pursue a career in women's health was an all-consuming passion, just as my mother's love of sports was for her. Eventually, my two worlds of nurturing and career collided with each other. When my children were age 2 and 4, I stopped delivering babies in order to spend more time with them. This decision was very difficult, especially since I had gone into OBGYN because of my love for delivering babies. Still, mothering my children and spending a significant amount of time with them was now my highest priority. Enter the mother bear. What is the most dangerous beast in a forest? A mother bear who is protecting her young. She knows what it takes to keep her young safe, but she also knows what to teach them so that when the time is...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.